So here we are for another in the series of films, The Eight Protections of Tara. Now, I've got them written down here in this bowl. Now, I don't know if you can notice, but I've got this funny thing on my eye. It's gone all red, so it looks a bit odd. That's why. Hopefully that will pass soon. So now we've done... Never mind, it's not going to work. Right, okay, here we are. I was going to make a little joke. I was going to say, we've done Demons and Doubt.
I think, have we?
So, let's do another one. Right, we're going to do that one. Oh, now, you probably can't see this. It probably won't show. Nah, it's not going to show, the lighting's wrong. Ah, there we go. Pride and Lions. Okay. So now the first thing to say about these things, these eight things from which Tara protects us, well, it's just worth reminding ourselves, I think, that we all know that these things are not good. All right. So there's no point in me sitting here going, oh, it's really bad if you're proud because they're 90-90-90. We all know that. Okay. So we just like park that as, we'll just take that as read. We understand that. So the model that I use, the kind of the mechanism that I use to look into things is to first of all take as read the fact that it's not a good thing. Pride is not a good thing. But pride's quite interesting linguistically in the English language. Because there are essentially two types of pride. There's arrogance and there's sort of dignity. All right. Now, in French, they have two separate words for that. They have the arrogance type pride. They have the word orgueil, orgueil. And for the other one, they have fierté, like fier. Proud. So you've got the positive pride and the negative pride, the sort of arrogance puffed up side of it. But in English, we've only got one word for it. So that's quite an interesting thing to note. Anyway, the mechanism is you look at the thing in itself, so pride, and then look at its opposite. And then we can begin to work with the thing in itself. So to my mind, the opposite of pride is shame. Okay. So in the matter of shame, I think shame grows up in a person, grows up in us, when we feel like an object. Okay. We feel like an object, not a person. It grows up when shame arises in us and kind of takes up residence in us. When we are valued not for what we are and who we are and our innate qualities in and of themselves. Shame grows up in us when we are valued for our use, our purpose for somebody else. And I think the setting in which shame grows up in us is the most strongly and the most kind of pervasively and tenaciously is in childhood. If we have one or both parents or an adult carer of some sort, who, as I say, doesn't value us simply because we are. They value us because we serve some purpose for them. Maybe we serve the purpose of assuring their material security. Okay. You know, maybe there are some people for whom if they didn't have a child, they would have no leverage over somebody else in order to keep a roof over their head and food in their belly. We may serve a purpose in so much as we are a kind of vessel for somebody else's negativity. You know, just being on the receiving end of somebody else's anger or contempt. We may serve a purpose in that we are kind of roped into doing lots of things for somebody that we kind of, you know, that they should be doing for themselves, but they make us do it. We can serve a purpose in being a kind of lightning conductor, a kind of channel through which somebody exits their own unpleasant emotion and kind of houses it in us. It's a huge, huge problem, I think, this, because if that happens to us and we become imbued with shame, we will then compensate for that shame by puffing ourselves up with pride to try to compensate for it. And as such, because we haven't dealt directly with the shame and we kind of, as I say, cover it up with pride, there's a bit more of a likelihood that we might then go on and do the same to other people. Now, this thing of serving a purpose for somebody, and when that happens to us when we're children, is that we don't realise that that is what's going on. You know, all children pretty much think that the way it is in their household is normal. And it's not until later on in our lives that we maybe start comparing our setup with other people's setup and sort of seeing that things are different. But what happens in that respect when we are used, if I can put it as neutrally as that, as a tool, in essence, for somebody else, as an instrument? We become a kind of an appliance. It's dehumanizing. It's profoundly dehumanizing. And that's what makes it shameful. We cease to sort of really, really feel our humanity. And we become an object, a thing, with a range of uses and purposes. And deep down inside us, we know that. We can sense it. And so we vault fast that. We jump over that pain and adopt a kind of proud demeanor. So there we go. Now, again, I don't know for sure how chanting Om Tari Tu Tari Turi Soha 108 times every day over a period of time protects us against pride. But I do think, in my experience, through doing that practice, it becomes possible to encounter the painful aspects of the shame of being an object, a tool, an appliance, and being valued for what we can do for somebody else, as opposed to being valued for simply being, just for being, and then, you know, for being who and what we are and our innate qualities. It's very, very painful. And it is perhaps easier to encounter that pain and release it when one is engaged in a very, very kind of wholesome, but very thorough spiritual practice, such as the chanting of the Green Tara Mantra Om Tari Tu Tari Turi Soha 108 times a day, every day. By dismantling and diffusing the shame. And one can really only do that by encountering the sadness and the grief of that, that one is not valued or was not valued for oneself, rather for what one could do for somebody else. And of course, that comes with the deal that if you don't do that thing for somebody else, you get rejected. Very, very painful. But by encountering that pain and facing it, and what they call processing it, i.e. crying your eyes out, the shame can be diffused, and then the pride can be progressively dropped. So there we go. Pride and lions. And yes, the lions aspect of it. I mean, the lions are dangerous and they kill people. And they have big sharp teeth and claws and the killer instinct. And the damage that they can do is in this respect akin to the damage that pride can do. You know, acting in a proud and sort of haughty and arrogant manner towards others can lacerate their spiritual flesh and leave them bleeding. So there we go. I guess that's why lions are linked with pride. And we also have the rather beautiful linguistic, the collective noun of a pride of lions. So there we go. Pride and lions, and pride and shame. Thank you for watching.